There's a fine line between fine art and stupidity. I think I just crossed it. I was so nervous, I think I drew it up standing down. That might be my first time drawing Yosemite Sam with nipples. Oh my gosh. All right. Heart's beating a little bit fast right now. Last time I spoke to a crowd like this was at an AA meeting. And, wait a minute, a lot of you laughing at familiar faces. Were you at that meeting? Wait a minute. Anyways, I'm the entertainment for the night. Like you said, I am Thomas Kincaid. Back like Tupac for the second, third album. Anyways, wow, that was kind of crazy. We're going to talk a little bit about the art tonight. We'll eventually get to, I'm going to let you know a lot of secrets about my life. You know, wake you guys back up. So are you guys cool with that? So first of all, as George said, I've been a very busy boy. Right now I'm painting my most expensive canvas. It's an Indy car for a guy named Hinchcliffe, who was just on Dancing with the Stars. So I'm doing that. No pressure, just, $2 million car. And lots of fun projects. I got my own vodka out and, things like that. So lots of fun things like that. We're getting ready when I get back home, which is in just 2 days. We're filming something with Fox News, and then I'm being honored at, what casino is it? Not the one where I've gambled the most or lost the most money. I believe it's Red Rock, but they're doing St. Jude's is honoring me for all the money that I've raised, so I think that's exciting. So, but this last 2 years, so I don't know, maybe you guys are familiar with a show called Counting Cars with Danny from, there we go. We love cars, don't we? Yeah, and women like shoes? Listen, I saw more bad shoes last night in the casino than I've seen in a long time. Woo! It was bad. But I did something for a biography channel. I just finished filming on the History Channel with Danny Coker, and sold one of my cars to DJ Ashbrook, who was there from Guns N' Roses. And it was a lot of fun. And the unfortunate thing is that they kept talking about, I was watching with my daughter, they kept talking about how, how much better the car's going to look without the olives on the side of it. So, Maddie's like, she's like, Dad, she goes, they keep mentioning how, the car's going to look so much better without your artwork on it. And I said, Maddie, I go, actually, this show's seen by like 30 million people, plus it's syndicated. So every time they mention the olives and they mention, my name, it gives us a good thing, right? So, of course, first thing I do is I call my friends and I say, hey, did you happen to catch it, on History Channel? This is what they basically said. They go, looks like you gained a lot of weight. So I don't know how to take that. So in preparation for this cruise, right now I'm wearing Spanx for the first time. But I said, what do you mean I look heavy? They go, well, you just look like you gained weight. And I go, well, maybe, I don't know. I go, but the camera adds 10 pounds. Everybody knows that adds 10 pounds. So they said, well, how many cameras did you have on you? I don't know how to take that. So the other thing I did in preparation for this cruise is I've been on an all-liquid diet, which is not easy. So the last 2 weeks, been an all-liquid diet, beer, vodka. And I'm doing very good. So far, I've lost 4 days. Lost 4 days and counting. I'm going to try we'll get through this together. How many have cruised before? Lots? Everybody? Yeah. So I cruise a lot too, and one of the rumors that's been going around on cruise ships for a long time, and not just cruise ships, actually it's just everything, is that the art is worth more with the artist when he passes. Okay, that's complete BS. I need you guys to spread the rumor where the art's worth more with me alive. I don't want to be standing next to Lebo on the ship going, hey guys, we bought like 10, 20 pieces of your work. It's been nice knowing you. Jordan's out here going, well, the prices just went up, right? You guys probably working together. It's kind of funny how last week he called my doctor to see how my health was. I don't know what that means. But I give that a lot of thought, and I decided I want to go peacefully in my sleep. Giving a lot of thought, actually. I want to go peacefully in my sleep the same way my grandfather did, not like the other 5 screaming passengers in his car. And I'm kidding, Grandpa. Totally kidding. So having a good time. The other thing that we have been asked a lot since I was on this ship is so, you know, what night are you entertaining? Or I watch your magic show all the time. Like, how is it? How do you levitate, right? You know, or I also got that, you know, they confuse me with this, the guy from Rock of Love, right? So they're like, hey, and I go, listen, that guy's got blonde hair, he's got blue eyes, both of his arms are sleeved, he's super good looking. Of course that's me. So, you saw Carrot Top at the end. Now, he's a good friend of mine. And so I was just at one of his shows, and we hang out a lot. And so he comes by, and I'm in the audience with my cousin and a few other friends. And he goes, well, since Goddard's here, I can tell you two things. First of all, I had to give away free tickets. So he wasn't real thrilled about that. He goes, and second thing, it looks like Elton John threw up all over him. He is so sparkly. Like, just look at him. Like, shoes. Right? They're fun. But I'm just like you, okay? I put my eyeliner on the same way as all you ladies do. And so we hang out a lot. So we were in Caesar's Palace actually going to see Elton John. And this is kind of funny because this happens to us all the time. And I get a lot of this too. People come running up and they go, can I take a picture with you? Sure. So who are you anyway? What do you mean? Well, I know you're somebody. Technically, we're all somebody. You know, every zoo's a petting zoo, right? Depending on your level of risk, right? So anyway, so I'm standing there with Carrot Top, and we start to get a little line around us of, gosh, I'm sweaty. This is very hot lights. But I'm not going to strip, so we're good. Yeah, that's not going to happen. My Spanx will come off. It'll be like that movie, The Heat, where she goes, what the heck do you have under there? So Carrot Top and I are standing there. We start to get a crowd around us. And there's a couple comes up next to us and comes up next to me. And I've sort of just moved to the back. Because, you know, Carrot Top's super famous. I mean, he's been the face of the Wendy sign for like 20 years. just kidding, wherever we go. And... that's really mean for a friend. That's, yeah. A little bit, though. There's a resemblance. And Sean White from, you know, the... Anyway. So we're standing there, and so the couple says to me, goes, so, hey, so what band do you play in? And I go, well, actually, I don't play in a band. No, seriously, we won't tell anybody, like, what band do you play in? Seriously, I don't play in a band. So, you know, Scott can hear them, and he turns around and goes, he doesn't play in a band. He's a painter. They go, you're a painter? Commercial or residential? Well, if you want to know the truth, but do you paint? I paint olives. Do you own a car? So then they turn to me and they go, no, seriously, what band do you play in? Story of my life. Moving on from that, and just how about all the fun we have. So, doing a lot of things with the different charities, and we have two new family members, I guess, in the family. And I know a lot of you have dogs, but we just got two pugs, and yeah, right? God's sense of humor is a pug. Let me tell you something. No joke. This 2 days before we left for this trip, the pool man comes back to clean the pool. Leanne's, and I love Leanne, of course. And I love your pugs. This is my fiance, by the way. This is Leanne. Can you stand up and say hi? Stand up, yeah. I told her, now we haven't set a wedding date yet, but I told her when we do get married, I'm going to be a trophy husband. Obviously. Just not a first place trophy. Maybe not even a third or fourth place trophy, but I will be a trophy husband. So she brought her two pugs. They just came to us from Arizona. So the pool man's there. And the pug, no joke, she's, like you can tell. there's no branch on that tree, I guess. And the pug is barking, but not only, this is how talented a pug is. There's not only barking, but farting at the same time. That is a pug in a nutshell. The pug snores louder than I do. And then you get the two of them going, oh my goodness. So, but I love them. So I am filled with a house filled with estrogen because I've got, you know, my beautiful lady. I have my 22-year-old daughter who is, I'm her bank account. I see her like once a week. Then Leanne also has a 22-year-old son who's totally got his act together. And really cool. And then we have a 3-year-old and a 4-year-old daughter that live with my ex, but we get to see them a few days a week. And that's Max and Catalina. And I'll tell you, as you know, when she's around, I don't even exist. But that's okay. I'm getting used to it. So with all of them in the house at the same time, it's a little bit crazy. And I remember my family's almost all women anyway. That's how I learned to dance, is waiting for the bathroom. That's where the Irish came out of me. And so we have a house filled with estrogen. And but what's cool is that, kids change your life, obviously, because as soon as you have a kid, Jordan, Jordan's a new daddy. Did you guys know that?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's awesome. So what happens is you start doing weird things like wearing your seatbelts. not pissing off your wife. There's things you learn to do. But so I figured out, just because I'm a math guy too, is that by the time the kids are in high school, I'll be in my 70s. Yeah, so basically they'll be like, your grandpa's here, and I'll be like, no, actually, they're dead. I feel a little bit like Clint Eastwood, you know what I mean? Like, I did get lucky. But anyway, so I have to tell you a funny story about my 4-year-old. I'm going to get to the art eventually, I promise. Are you guys okay? Are we still awake? Okay. All right, we're good. So we all have mothers, obviously. I've known mine my whole life. So my mom was coming over to the house the first time, when my daughter was turning one. Very, very excited. She'd seen the baby for the first time. And so she brought a couple presents, and my 22-year-old is there in the room with me. And she's got all kinds of things. She's got a whole box full of different things. And she pulls out this jacket, and it's bright orange. Orange is not my color. I like black, so it makes me look thinner, hopefully. And with these spanks, God, they're killing me, honey. Seriously, I'm really going to wear these all night. If I let this thing loose, it's going to scare people. So my mom is there, and she's showing me this jacket. It's got a little fur, thing around it. Sleeves look kind of short, but what do us men know about fashion? I mean, seriously, if our women did not dress us, God knows what we'd look like. So, I see my daughter giggling at this jacket or whatever, and I know what's going on. My mom leaves the room, and I go, Maddie, go, what's going on? I go, there's something going on. You're over here giggling the whole time. She goes, Dad, it's a dog jacket. I'm like, oh my God. I went into sheer panic because, we all have things that we've gotten from our parents or grandparents that we would never wear, but it's a dog jacket. And if I told my mother that she had bought a dog jacket, she'd literally be in tears. And I am panicking. I don't know what to do. My daughter gives me great advice. She says, look at Dad, you put her in the jacket and you get her to smile and you tell her that she loves it. So I'm all, okay, sounds like a good idea. So she does. She goes, by the way, Dad, did you notice how long it was in the back? I go, yeah, it did look kind of good. Did you notice a hole in the back? This is for a tail. I'm all, seriously, I didn't, right? Like, I have selective hearing. It's not just because I have an AARP card. And I call up my aunt. My aunt lives very close to my mom. And so I call my aunt and I say, listen, mom's coming home today. She's flying home. Will you just give me a call and let me know that she's got back okay and all that? By the way, I got a really weird question to ask you. She goes, what's that? She goes, is it about the dog jacket? Yeah. I go, how did you know? She goes, Michael, I was with your mom when she bought the dog jacket. I go, oh my goodness, tell me the story. So she goes, well, this is what happened. She goes, we're in Target. There's this big bin there that's got, this sale of dog clothing. Your mom doesn't read the sign. All she sees is, 75% off sale. You guys know what I'm talking about. You women, doesn't matter. So she goes up, she gets the jacket, she gets in line, and the cashier says to her, oh, do you have a dog? She says, no, I don't have a dog. She goes, oh, well, is this jacket for your dog? She goes, how dare you? It's for my granddaughter, and I don't have a dog. So the lady's like, my aunt's like, I'm not messing with Rita. So I go, I totally get it. Now, every time Leanne and I pass by like a PetSmart, we're going, I wonder if we should go clothes shopping for the kids. I'll tell you something else funny. I don't know why. Now, like I said, I've known my mom my whole life. Seriously, I have. And when she calls up, she will still identify herself. I mean, I'm 54 years old, and my mom will call up and she'll go, hi, Michael, this is your mom. Yeah. I'm like, seriously, I know. And we just went to go get Leanne a phone, And, you know, they have all kinds of phones now. They got the Android, the i6, i7, iPhone, whatever. And we're trying to decide, and I go, tell me a little bit about the phones, because they all look the same to me. And they go, well, this one holds, like, you know, 45. I go, give me the most powerful thing you got. This one holds 45,000 songs or one voicemail from your mother. Okay. I said, I'll take that one. So, not to bag on my mother. My mom is super, super awesome. Very, very strict, always correcting my English. You know, so if I have bad English, it's not my mom's fault. Yeah, it's my fault completely. But so there's this thing now. Now my oldest daughter, like I said, her name is Maddie. She's 22, and we do a lot of these things. This is another reason I know I'm getting older, is because we do all these events for, you know, cystic fibrosis, which, you know, my niece has. And for MS, and a lot of things for Wounded Warriors and the SPCA, which is No Kill Dog Shelters. I love that. And also, I've been a member of St. Jude's now on their board for the last 3 years. So, yeah, it's all about the good you give that, you know, that comes back. So, anyways, I'm at one of these events, and I'm standing. Now, I rarely get nervous around any sort of celebrity, but I'm with the William Shatner, right? So I'm like, oh my gosh. So I'm standing there with William, Bill, and I take a picture, and there's two young people about my daughter's age. One of them says, hey, who is that guy you're with? I said, that's Captain Kirk from Star Trek for 20 years. His buddy goes, no, it's not. That's the guy from Priceline.com. You know what I mean? So the other time it happened, this wasn't that long ago, we're coming down from a party with Nicolas Cage and Robin Leach, and it was Vince Neil's 50th birthday party, and we came down from the party, and my buddy said, would you like to meet Mike Tyson? I'm like, oh my gosh, I'd love to meet Mike Tyson. So we went downstairs, and I met Mike and his entourage, and it was absolutely amazing experience. So we took pictures with him, my daughter got to take pictures with him, and I say to my daughter, I go, by the way, do you know who that was? She goes, duh, Dad. That's the guy who owned the Tiger and Hangover. Anyway, so I'm gonna get serious for just a second. So all the paintings that you're gonna see, they're all originals, and there's some really, really special paintings here. But I always paint the things that are going on in my life, and so they include, you know, all sorts of different themes in that. And but I have to say this, you know, one of the things that's really important to me is, like I said, it's the philanthropy. So I don't. I mean, I've always known I was, like, a little bit different. I remember being in, like, first grade, being the only 15-year-old. And, by the way, when I drink, my the Mensa program puts me on probation. So, by the way, that's another reason why I wear the bling, is because I spent 12 years as an engineer, and this hides my nerdiness. So, the reason for the long hair is because every 6 years we cut it for something called Locks of Love. So, I'm right there. And, but it kind of hides my nerdy side. The second thing, and you guys know this as cruisers, that that, you know, every time I go through security, I get a free massage. Not too dumb. But I have lots of people in my family that are nurses and involved in the nursing field, and I wanted to tell you that's a career I could never do. I don't know how those of you that are involved in the medical field or those of you that are doctors, how you do what you do, where you could go in and you can take care of a patient and then knowing that their life is hanging on the balance, so that you might not see them the next week and not get your emotions involved, where you can still do your job. And I have to say a big thank you to those of you that are involved in that. Thanks. And also those of you that are involved in firefighting or law enforcement. And I will tell you something else. Now, I'm not always kind to you firemen or you know, cops, because sometimes you're a little bit round. I can't help it. It's an olive or a grape. Sometimes the firemen are, you know, barbecuing, you know, whatever. But I will tell you that, and I think we can all agree that when you are called to service and you're putting your life on the line for others, that you're worth every single penny that you get paid. So thank you so much for that. I could not. Now, let's get something straight. My job is not exactly easy either, because you don't know how hard it is to get an olive to hold still for an entire painting. It is not. Now, I know I paint some sexy strawberries, but most of them are divas. They give me a hard time. The olives, Lord, I have no idea. But and for some reason, you know, I really think that the reason that I'm able to have any measure of success is because of the guy upstairs. and because he gave me something because he knew how I was going to do something with it that really counted. Because you know what? I enjoy a wonderful circus. I'm telling you, I get to be on TV and have all these celebrity friends, and I get to travel the world and you know, hang out with people like, you know, like Jordan, and go, you know, all over the world and share my art. And at the same time, at 3 o'clock in the morning, thinking, really, why am I here? What difference am I making? And it's about the philanthropy. It really, really is. And there's one other group that I have to mention that is so, so ultimately important. And that is that, you know, back in World War I and World War II and even the Korean War, you know, when our soldiers came back, they were celebrated as heroes. And, you know, for weeks on end, the military, that came back from those wars were treated like heroes. And the entire United States was, you know, in revelry for, you know, two, three weeks at a time. And then something kind of funny happened with Vietnam. And those people that came back, my father served in Vietnam, and so did my uncle. And they never talked about what they did. And I've met many, many people involved in all different sorts of tours. And even now, there's a lot of us that are in this room right now that either have friends or family that have kids that are serving, you know, in the Middle East, where we don't know who the enemy even is. But I want to tell you, it's that, you know, Leanne and I spend a lot of time with working with Wounded Warriors. And I know they've had a little bit of controversy, but they're a great organization, and they do a lot of good. We also are trying to help those with PTSD, because what happens now, right? And this expands in far beyond just, you know, the military, but I mean, in the old days, back in World War I and World War II, they called it shell shock. I mean, literally, you'd see things that humans are not supposed to see, and you'd go blind with perfect vision. So, I mean, and same thing with you firefighters and policemen. You're having to go into a situation, and then you're supposed to suck it up, and the next day everything's fine. It is not like that. And I think it's time, finally, you know, that you know, the United States recognizes our vets in a really big way. We need to get it together. Hopefully, I mean, our choices this year were criminal or crazy. But, good Lord. But again, you know, I do believe that, you know, the United States is finally starting to recognize our vets, you know. And Leanne and I have had, we were at back east, and we had a two-star general come up to me. So she, thank you so much for the things you've done for our vets. And I said, you're welcome very much. I said, by the way, you know, I served 6 tours, and some of the bravest men I had served in Vietnam. We also had that nurse that came. She was a medevac. And she said, listen, when I came back from Vietnam and I was walking through the airport, people were throwing tomatoes at me and spitting at me. So I think it's time now, you know, because the Vietnam generation was my father and your father, and our grandfathers were, you know, part of the war behind them. And so I just want to say that it's the land of the free because of the brave. And thank you so much for your service. I will just lastly wrap it up with, I know the artist who did these paintings. And so we're going to talk a little bit about that, but I just want to say thank you for putting me in this wonderful, wonderful position, because the position that I'm in is that I can call up celebrities and I can say, hey, listen, you know, we have, can I have like 2 minutes, Warren? Let me tell you something. I know I talk a lot. So I have some friends of ours that I met on a cruise, and cruise is a great place to meet people, because you have, you find somebody and you end up being lifelong friends and that. So we met a neurosurgeon. She's absolutely brilliant and a little bit nerdy like me, but that's better looking and blonde and whatever. And her husband is a heart doctor. And they called me and Leanne, actually, just a few weeks ago. We've become best friends. We've stayed in touch almost every day. And they called me up a few weeks ago, and they said, listen, you know, and they both have great access to the best doctors there are. They're both very astute doctors in Florida. And they said, listen, our daughter has Crohn's disease, and I don't know much about Crohn's disease, but they said, listen, this week she had to go to the hospital, and she's literally hanging by a thread, and I know, you know, you're lots of fun. Could you just make a fun video or something to cheer her up? She's going to be on an all-liquid diet, and she's going to be here for 2 weeks, and the doctors are saying they don't think she's going to make it. And he goes, you're the only person I know that has lost a daughter, and so I'm just reaching out to you as a friend. And so I did this video for her. It was very silly. But I kept the camera really close to me, and I said, hey, you know, I don't do my hair like this for anybody. And as I backed up, you know, my camera, I had it like pet detected where it stood up like 10 inches tall. And then I got off the phone and finished with the video and just tried to give her some words of encouragement. And I called up every celebrity friend I know. And I said, listen, I have a favor to ask you. Will you spend just about maybe 5 or 10 seconds making a short little video for me that I can send to this little girl? She's only 15 years old, and she's a kid. And I said, I just need to lift her spirits. So I will share just a couple of videos. And you won't be able to see them, but I will I'll play you some of the audio.
How's that?
It's very short. Promise, Jordan. I don't have my readers on. Okay, let's see here. Videos. You guys know what it's like.
Yes.
All right, let's see here.
I don't think you want to show that one.
Okay.
Andy Coker here out in Vegas. Counts Customs, counting cars, and good friend of your man, Mr. Michael Goddard. He told me you're not feeling well. I just want you to know that my thoughts and my prayers are going out for you for a speedy recovery. Morgan, get well quick, darling.
Right?
Yeah.
Morgan, this is John Payne from the band Asia. Talking to you from Las Vegas in my house with Lucy on my shoulder. Lucy, say hi to Morgan. Hello.
I got about 20 of these. I'm going to just rush through just a couple here.
Hey, Morgan, it's Chris Angel and Marcel.
Marcel's is a monkey,
and I just wanted to wish you a very fast recovery. Heard you weren't feeling so good, and I hope you get well fast.
There's just lots and lots and lots of these. Just, oh, well, here, this one's a little weird, so just no laughing.
Hey, Morgan, it's me, Buddy Carrot Top. I'm in my robe. Sorry, I just woke up and Michael likes seeing me in a robe. But I hope you feel better. I heard that you weren't feeling well, and I hope I cheer you up. I hope you feel better. I don't know who made. Look at this painting behind me. This is. I know it's not Godard, because that's good.
Last one. I'll show you one more.
Hey, Morgan, this is Mike Tyson, and I'm wishing you a speedy recovery. Okay, and wish you the best of luck. All right. Have God be with you,
right?
And take care.
So I just want to say thank you. Thank you for putting me in a position where I can do something. Here's the good news. Morgan got out of the... 2 days later, she was out of the hospital and is home doing great. She was on the edge. And her spirits, if you guys know, just a lot of times, I remember when I lost my grandmother, or my grandfather, my grandmother was just right on the edge. They'd been together forever. A lot of times they go together because they've lost, you know, half their soul. And that's when you need to get around them and say, hey, listen, we all love you. We all still want you around. And as we know, illness strikes everybody. There's not a person in this room who hasn't been affected by cancer or MS or dementia or anything. It's what we put in that counts, not what we get out. And so I want to tell you, I'm in a position where, you know, like I told Michael Jordan wanted to be turned into an olive, by the way. So I painted him as an olive, along with many others. But I told him, I said, Mr. Jordan, you know what I love most about you is your philanthropy. And he goes, you know what? When I became a public figure, and I've been a public figure for a long time, I felt it was my obligation to be a role model for those kids who, you know, are want to mimic me and want to be me. And I want to do the same thing. I want to, you put me in a position that a lot of people aren't in, where I can call up celebrities and things, and lift the human spirit. And to, you know, now my friends are saying, you saved our daughter's life. I did nothing. You know who did something? Was you. Because you put me in the position through my art that has helped make me, you know, accessible to things that I can do that other people might not have the chance to do. So for me, it's not an opportunity, it's an obligation. So anyways, God bless you all.
Thank you, Michael Goddard, ladies and gentlemen. Also known as the Olive Guy. Now tomorrow we'll get more into the art, but he's been very busy and he's working very hard, so the collection is spectacular. It's going to be the largest collection you've seen from our guest artists. We put it together, and it's going to be just a great show tomorrow. You're going to see, I think more than 60 works by him, which is amazing. And a lot of people don't realize, I mean, yes, he tries to put positive messages, works, but he's got a spirituality to him as well. This is probably the most important and largest original left on Earth, really. There's no more large originals left.
We had one other published original. This is going to be a published original, and so...
That means it's being turned into a print, but this is the original.
Yeah, so to kind of put it into perspective, if I'm doing... Say I'm designing an album cover, and now it's going to be reproduced for the next, like, 30 years. I'll spend a lot more time doing it. And what happens with the published originals is after we've sold out the prints... then it goes on to go into the licensing, and you know, a wine company might contact me and say, "Hey, we'd like to put on over wine bottles and this and that." The thing about the published paintings is that you can take like, okay, there's a painting that's called "The Three Rocks and a Virgin." Okay, anybody heard of the Mona Lisa? Okay, same artist. The difference is the difference is the significance of the painting. So right now we're doing a new documentary. We're doing some new filming with Park West. I'm coming out with a new book, and this is also going to be featured in some of the television shows I'm going to be doing. And there's very, very few. In fact, we only had two, and the last one just sold last week for $155,000. So you're going to find things in range. I think this year we sold the paint for $355. Last year we sold one for $450. So a lot of them are eclipsing the $100,000 mark. It's gotten to where I can't even afford my own artwork. But the point is that the significance of the painting, the reason that this painting is so significant is because it can be shared by millions of people. So without showing what a total math nerd I am, there's about 3,000 people per week that are on a cruise ship that might possibly see it. Times 4 is 12,000, and then you take that 12,000 times 12 months, you're at 100, and then you multiply that by 104 ships. You're just under like 15 million people a year that will see it just through Park West. You can go into Costco, you can go into Bed Bath & Beyond, you can see my posters and things there. But again, amongst my works, this is very significant. So I'm no Leonardo, but I did outsell Van Gogh. Not in price, but at least while he was alive. Which, by the way, is worth a lot more than alive. What is all that $220 million going to do for this painting after I'm dead, right? I can't take it in the casino.
No, right? Take your chips.
So this is very significant that way. The other thing that we did was very, very special is... I've always admired people who kind of change it up and change, you know, so bands especially, I think people like Aerosmith and, you know, all that.
I love that it doesn't have your typical imagery. I love that
it doesn't. But it's the only one left. We sold the last one we had last week. This was done it was finished up about 3 weeks ago.
Just got it framed,
and we've had incredible response to it, and on our social media. So it's Michael Godard and Godard's Crazy Life. A lot of fun things happen, but a lot of people are going to see this. I know we did a live video just like 3-4 weeks ago, Leanne, where we had 140,000 people watched us live. It was really cool,
yeah.
And lots of responses to that. So, and also it's the exposure has been so crazy that I've been cruising for such a long time that The Simpsons decided to do an episode, a parody of Michael Goddard. Did you know that? So Bart goes convinces his parents to go on a cruise ship. And I have the photo with me, but he convinced them to go on a cruise ship. So he says, "What do I do with this garbage?" And it's one of my paintings. Bart's holding a martini glass that has two olives and bikinis. So that was hilarious. So everyone says, "God, you've made it." Yeah, so I'll just leave it at that. But
if you're on The Simpsons, that means you're relevant, right? I mean, yeah. They're not going to waste an episode for people no one's ever heard of, right? So
it's fun. The other thing that I do is, like I said, I like to change it up. So I have something called my Moonlight Paintings here. And this is something I'm just going to be doing for a little while. Those of you that have seen me, like, I don't know, maybe 15 years ago, I was doing some olive and toothpick pop art paintings. And I don't know what they sold for, maybe like $1,500 now. We've seen a couple of them come up for auction through Park West for like $15,000. So it's really, really crazy. But I just do these for a little while, and they're lots of fun. And I have these narrow pieces because I know you guys have tons of room in your house for, you know, more paintings. All the paintings have a story. Over there is Lemon Drop, and so and right next to us is Push Your Lever, something I see in the gym. There's an Elvis painting over there. There's a piece right here that has to do with the court. Normally, I don't talk about court cases, but let's put this into perspective. Seriously, let's all think about this together as one mind, and you tell me if you agree with me or not. Who wants to put their fate in the hands of 12 people who weren't even smart enough to get out of jury duty? Hello. But But when an attorney retires, he either goes on to become a judge, or maybe, I call this kind of like, I rest my case, or maybe it's just the fact that he's pissed off because he lost the case. The truth of this particular painting, gosh, I'm already throwing it out there. So I was, there was a person that was being deposition, and they were starting to incriminate themselves, and they're trying to sue me for whatever, I don't know, just to make money. And so they're trying to sue me, and the other person started to, you know, just basically make their testimony an absolute whore. So the attorney is not allowed to talk or coach during the deposition. So the attorney literally took the briefcase and threw it across the room. I said, that's a painting. So there he is right there. Elvis from Vegas. And a lot of these you'll notice are romance because, again, I'm always painting what's going on in my life. And, of course, my beautiful girl, Leanne. I remember my mom telling me ever since I was a kid that, you know, if you see a shooting star, make a wish, because there's, you know, lots of wonderful, wonderful things are going to happen. So here are two grapes, and they are looking at the moon, and there's lots of stars going by. So that's kind of like my way to get points with my girl. Is it working? A little? So, like Jordan said, this is going to be the largest collection of art that I've had and have right now currently available, the only published painting available in the entire world right now. And again, you know, those of you that have seen my artwork before, and I know a lot of you have, I really want to come and show you something new that you haven't seen before. So this collection was specially chosen for this particular cruise. And, yeah, right?
So tomorrow we have a huge collection. It's going to be it's just going to be an awesome day. So Michael Goddard, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you. So we're going to head off to dinner here, and tomorrow morning we're at 10:30 back upstairs. It's going to be a big collection. It's going to be a great day. Everything from the small piece, published original, meaning it's being turned into prints, but there's only one original. His Moonlight series, I think we have 7 of them. We almost always virtually sell them out. So again, we have 7 of them. So again, 10:30 sharp, we'll open the doors. Come on in. You know how it works. We'll have the price list. He'll be there to talk more about the paintings tomorrow, describe them. And it's just going to be a very cool day to collect some Goddards.
Thank you for putting up with me and staying awake. I love you all. For all of you.
All of you. So we got just a couple minutes. The dining room opens. You can come check out these paintings.